Hello, this is Dr. Anderson with Apollo Audiobooks. I'm going to go through the handout that we gave to all the attendees at the live conference, and I'm going to go through it verbatim. I'll also include a little extra information. The handout is basically given to you so that you can have a written record that you can keep with you, and I encourage you to print off a copy of the handout and keep that in your kitchen. And print off another copy and maybe give it to your spouse if your spouse does the grocery shopping. And you can even keep a copy at the office. So take the handout with you and use that information. But we're going to go through it verbatim for those of you who will be watching this on the internet or for those of you who will be listening to the audiobook version of this conference. So this is the handout from Weight Loss 101, the Cut the Killer Carbs Conference. And basically, we're going to cover a lot of the do's and the don'ts, but let's start off with the basics, okay? Basically, if you eat a diet that contains protein, fat, and green leafy vegetables, that'll get you there without having to count the carbs. Protein and fat includes meat, eggs, cheese. Eat all you want of those, and eat all you want of the green leafy vegetables. However, if you add other vegetables and foods, then that's when you start counting carbs. So let's say you don't just want to eat green leafy vegetables, but you want to add certain fruits or certain milk beverages, then you have to start counting the carbs to see how many are in those types of foods. Number three, if you want numbers, for most people, eating fewer than 60 grams of carbs a day will induce fat burning. So if you're a numbers person and you want to count the carbs, then try to keep your carbs below 60, and you should notice weight loss. However, for most people, eating fewer than 20 grams of carbs a day will induce rapid fat burning. So 60 for fat burning, and less than 20 for rapid fat burning. The numbers are different for every individual, so you have to tailor it to what works best for you. For example, you may be able to lose weight eating 80 grams of carbs a day, or you may have to eat 50 grams of carbs a day to lose weight. Now, just as in the conference, when I talk about carbs, I mean net carbs. So when it comes to counting carbs, you'll count net carbs, and that's what we'll talk about a little bit later. Number four, always eat until you're satisfied. When you eat the cut the killer carbs way, you should never feel hungry. You should never leave the table feeling hungry, and you should feel satisfied. What I do lots of times is I'll eat a plate, and then after that I'll eat more of the same sort of foods that I know I can eat as much as I want of, and then if I'm still hungry at that point, I'll eat nuts. And I don't emphasize nuts enough during the conference, I believe, but I'll tell you, you can have nuts for a snack, you can have nuts after a meal, you can have nuts before a meal. Nuts are really a wonderful food. They've got lots of good protein, lots of good fat, and they have minimal carbohydrates. So let's start out with the first section, which is the do's. You may hear me click a little bit here, and that's because I'm going through this just as you would go through it on your computer. So these are the do's, and the whole point of this section is that anything that's in the do's, eat as much as you want, any time of day, and if you want more, eat more. You can eat all of this you want without ever having to count carbs. This really worked for me because the whole idea of counting calories or counting carbs and tracking everything, that just seemed unnatural to me. I just wanted to know what I could eat and what I couldn't eat. I do occasionally count carbs if it's a new food or if it's something I'm unfamiliar with. So first of all, for the do's, do eat as much as you want with no carb counting. That's what makes up the main dishes in your plate. They make up most of your plate. Number one is meat. Meat includes hamburgers, steaks, rib roast, ribeye, New York strip, fajita steak, etc. Meat also includes pork, bacon, ham and sausage, pepperoni, hot dogs, lamb, venison, veal, and other meats. For all meats, you don't want it fried in any sort of batter, because the batter is made of wheat, and it contains refined carbs. Also for all meats, you can eat the skin and the fat of the meat. Don't be afraid of the fat. Number two, fish. Eat any kind of fish you want, including catfish, salmon, tuna, bass, flounder, snapper, halibut, mackerel, trout, crab, lobster, shrimp, scallops, oysters, clams, and any other kind. Eat all the fish you want. Number 3, birds. Birds include chicken, and whether it's the breast or the thigh, dark meat, white meat, whatever. Eat as much as you want. You can also have turkey, duck, or any other fowl or poultry. Number 4, eggs. We eat a ton of eggs. Eggs are really what make up the bulk of breakfast. It's either eggs or a protein smoothie. You can have eggs of any style, whole eggs, scrambled, poached, fried, or in any of a variety of omelets with permitted vegetables, and add salsa, you know, to spice things up. Number 5, fats and oils. You can have as much of the fats and oils as you like. It's no longer at the top of the food pyramid. As long as your body is burning fat, you can consume fat and your body will burn it. It's when you start consuming all the refined carbohydrates that your body produces too much fat in your blood. So you can have as much as you want of butter, lard, yes, even lard, coconut oil, olive oil, safflower oil, canola oil, walnut, grapeseed oil, sesame seed oil, and many of other variety of oils. Note, you will want to avoid hydrogenated or partially hydrogenated oils, such as those found in margarine and vegetable shortening. Those are known to be very bad for your heart. Number 6, green vegetables and non-starchy vegetables. Eat as much as you want. These include alfalfa sprouts, arugula, avocado, artichoke, asparagus, bok choy, bamboo shoots, broccoli, Brussels sprouts, butternut squash, cauliflower, cabbage, chard, chives, cucumber, dandelion greens, eggplant, endive, escarole, fennel root, and greens of all types, including beets, collard greens, and mustard greens, and turnip greens. Now, one thing about cauliflower. Cauliflower is a great substitute for rice or potatoes in a meal or a recipe. Other vegetables include green beans and string beans, kale, kohlrabi, jicama, leafy greens, leeks, lettuce of all types, including butter, Boston romaine, and iceberg, mushrooms, okra, onions, parsley, peppers, pumpkin radicchio, rhubarb, shallots, sprouts, spinach, scallions, snow peas, string beans, sugar snap peas, salad greens, summer squash, tomatoes, turnips. And turnips are a great substitute for potatoes in a recipe. Watercress, wax beans, and zucchini. The reason I wrote this really long list of vegetables is that there are so many vegetables in the produce department. And if you say, oh, I don't like vegetables, then you probably haven't tried them all. So, you know, go out and really find some vegetables that you love. Some other notes on vegetables. Any vegetable leaf is acceptable. Also, avoid potatoes. Avoid potatoes of any type. Also, avoid corn, because both potatoes and corn are starchy carbohydrate vegetables. Finally, carrots and other vegetables not listed, they may be starchy too, so be sure and check the carbs on anything that's not listed on this list. Next, number 7, low-carb protein smoothies. You can choose low-carb protein smoothies of any flavor you like, chocolate, vanilla, or strawberry. You can even use your own berries. You can use your own berries to flavor them, but you have to count the carbs in berries. The protein comes from either egg or whey protein, and it must be zero carb or close to zero carbs protein smoothie mix. You can add bulk to your smoothie by using ground flaxseed. The kind of smoothie I use is One World Whey, and One World Whey tastes like ice cream. It's a little bit more expensive. But there's a whole smoothie section in your grocery store, so go down there and, you know, just buy a canister and try it, and keep trying them until you find one that you really like. When you make your protein smoothies, number 1, you add ice. Number 2, you need to add a liquid, and the liquid that you can use can be heavy cream. Heavy cream really bulks it out and adds some good, healthy fat that you need. And it has less carbs than, say, skim milk. Number 8, low-carb and zero-carb snacks. These are the kind of snacks that I eat all the time. These include nuts. Nuts can be salted, raw, or cocoa-covered with sucralose. At the local big-box store here, they sell cocoa-covered almonds, which have sucralose on them, and they're a great substitute for chocolate. That way you get lots of protein, lots of healthy fats, you get your chocolate craving taken care of. They're a little bit sweet because of the sucralose, but they're low carb. Other snacks you can have include pork rinds, sugar-free jello, cheeses, meats, eggs. You can keep boiled eggs around. 100% flax seed crackers, protein smoothies, as mentioned in the section above, beef jerky, pepperoni, ham, or turkey rolls. Next, we're going to move on to the next section. The next section is do eat as much as you want, but for these foods, you need to start counting the carbs. Everything above that we just discussed, you can have as much as you want without counting the carbs. Everything below, now you start to count the carbs. So these foods that where you have to count the carbs are the ones that should be your side dishes. They should make up less than a third or a fourth of your plate. They're the small side dishes. And if you want to know how many carbs are in your food, just Google it. Google, quote, net carbs in X. Or if it's something that comes from a package, you can just read the label. You'll need to calculate the net carbs from the package. The net carbs equal the total carbohydrate minus the fiber. And we'll cover that in the section coming up. So, things that you can eat as much as you want, but you need to count the carbs are number one, full-fat fermented dairy. Number two, full-fat dairy. Number three, fruit of many varieties. And four, condiments. So first, number one, full-fat fermented dairy. This includes Greek yogurt. Now, for any kind of yogurt you're going to eat, it needs to be unsweetened and unflavored. If you want sweetener, you have to add calorie-free sweetener yourself. And if you want a flavor, you have to add berries yourself. If you let the food manufacturer do it for you, they're going to add a lot of extra carbs to your yogurt. Next, other full-fat fermented dairy includes cheeses, from goat to Swiss to blue to jalapeno to parmesan to mozzarella to Gruyere to cream cheese to cheddar to camembert. Just pick the kind of cheese that you like, that you love. There's a whole section of cheeses. Now, note, the cheeses and the yogurt should contain cultures in the ingredients list. That means it was made by actually culturing a milk product and not made by some chemist in a lab. And number two, fermented dairy will get you more fat and more protein in it with less carbs than milk. The fermentation process takes out some of the carbohydrates. Number two, the other type of foods you can eat, but you have to count the carbs, are full-fat fermented dairy. This includes heavy cream, whipping cream, sour cream, and other creams. Limited amounts of full-fat whole milk can be taken as well. And yes, whipping cream is okay. You can use it for your smoothies. You can whip it and put it on top of berries for a dessert. It's wonderful. Number three, fruit. You can have many varieties of fruit. The berries are the best, including strawberries, blueberries, raspberries, and even blackberries. Other fruit is okay as well if it's unsweetened or if you sweeten it yourself with an artificial sweetener. The exceptions to the fruits, or the fruits that you should really watch out for because they're super high carb, are bananas, pineapple, grapes, raisins, and any kind of dried fruit. Finally, number four, condiments. You can use as much mustard and mayonnaise and olives as you want. Olives can be black or green. Have all the pickles you want as long as they're pickled without sugar. You can use soy sauce and spices and other condiments, but be sure that the condiments do not contain sugar or that they're sweet, or count the carbs for the amount of the condiment that you have. So here's the next section. The next section is titled, but what if I want bread, sugar, tortillas, chocolate, cookies, pasta, potatoes, pizza, and ice cream? You know, what if you miss certain foods from your diet? When you start to miss certain foods from your diet, that's when you start to have to cook things, make things, and think about things out of the box a little bit. So don't deny yourself anything, but you'll have to work a little harder if you want things like different kinds of breads or pizza or ice cream. So let's do number one, when you want breads, cookies, and cakes. When you want breads, cookies, and cakes, it's time to cook. Use almond flour for sweeter breads, cookies, and cakes. You can buy it in bulk when it's on sale at your local grocer, or you can order it online at a website like Amazon.com, and if you have an Amazon Prime, then you'll get free shipping. You should sweeten your breads, cookies, and cakes that you make at home with a sweetener listed below. You can use garbanzo bean flour for breadier breads. And don't fall for packaged food corporate marketing. If they say, oh, this is a zero-carb bread, and it's made with all-natural cracked this, or is made with sprouted that. No. For the breads, you're going to need to make them yourself. Either use a garbanzo bean flour for breadier breads, or use almond flour for sweeter breads. Next, number two, when you want sugar. When you want sugar, there are certain acceptable sweeteners, and they're listed here in rough order. They are stevia, then xylitol, then Splenda, called sucralose, then Truvia, which is stevia and erythritol, Sweet and Low, which is saccharin, sorbitol, mannitol, and possibly NutraSweet, called aspartame. So if you want sugar, you know, avoid the table sugar entirely, and instead use one of the sweeteners on this list. Aspartame is controversial for some, and it may possibly impair weight loss. Number three, when you want tortillas. When you want tortillas, use one or two small corn tortillas. Small corn tortillas are so much better for you than wheat tortillas. They don't have the addictive exorphins in them, and they're going to have less carbs in them. However, a corn tortilla still has about 9 carbs per tortilla, so be sure and count the carbs. Note, you should avoid flour tortillas because of the wheat and the carbs. And number two, you need to avoid marketing scams, such as marketing that says, this is a 3-carb, giant, heart-healthy, whole grain, whole wheat tortilla. You know, don't fall for that. Just get, if you decide you're going to have a tortilla to wrap something in, just use 1 or 2 corn tortillas. Don't try and avoid the carbs by falling for some sort of corporate marketing. Number four, what about when you want chocolate? When you want chocolate, buy 85% or greater dark chocolate. Or you can eat diabetic chocolate, which is sweetened with xylitol or another sweetener listed above. Or you can try the cocoa-covered almonds, which are sweetened with sucralose, mentioned in the nuts and snacks section. If you want other hard candy, then you should buy diabetic zero-calorie candy. Most chocolate is simply cocoa-flavored sugar. They add a ton of sugar and just barely sprinkle in the cocoa. But you need to buy the good stuff. Buy the chocolate that's mainly cocoa with just a touch of sweetener added to make it taste good. Now, number five, when you want cookies. So when you want cookies and when you want bread, those are the times that you should really head to the kitchen. Because cookies and bread, you can make those yourself out of almond flour with an approved sweetener to where it has near zero carbs. And no packaged processed food company is gonna do that for you. So when you want cookies, you gotta head back to the kitchen. Use almond flour and sweeten with the sweeteners listed above. Use the chocolates listed above, and you can make great low-carb cookies that taste wonderful. Remember, don't fall for packaged food corporate marketing for cookies. In this case, you cook it. Number six, when you want pizza. Number six, when you want pasta. When you want pasta, instead of buying any kind of noodles, use spaghetti squash instead of spaghetti noodles. You can also use cauliflower instead of rice. There was a study done on some low-carb spaghetti noodles that said that they only had 3 net carbs per cup. And those low-carb spaghetti noodles actually raise the blood sugar just as high as regular spaghetti noodles. So that's another time when you really need to try not to fall for corporate marketing. Use a spaghetti squash instead of spaghetti noodles. You can put all the sauce on top, all the cheese, all the meat you want. None of that stuff will hurt your weight loss. What will hurt your weight loss is the actual noodles themselves. Next, number seven, when you want potatoes. If you want potatoes, use turnips, where you would usually use potatoes in a recipe. You can French fry turnips, and I've done this and my kids love it. You can mash turnips, grill them, or you can even cook them with the roast, just like you would regular potatoes. Now, what if you want a salty snack like potato chips? In that case, use salted nuts. That'll do the trick, and it'll do it without the carbohydrate hangover. Number eight, when you want pizza. Most all of the toppings that you would put on any pizza are low carb, but you get burned on the pizza crust. Recipes for low carb pizza crust are out there, and there are some in the Wheat Belly Cookbook. Alternatively, you can use a corn tortilla, one corn tortilla stacked really high with toppings. That minimizes the carb load and maximizes the toppings, and it tastes great. But you do need to count the carbs in the tortilla. Finally, what about when you want ice cream? When you want ice cream, choose a low-carb protein smoothie. Blend it with ice and heavy cream. Pick a flavor of protein smoothie that you like or add berries. And you can put whipped cream right on top, just like you would a milkshake. And you can sweeten it with an acceptable sweetener if you need to. As I mentioned, I choose One World Way, and you can Google that. It's more expensive, but it is absolutely delicious. Here are a few other important concepts. Number one, be patient. The longer you've been heavy, or the longer you've been overweight, the longer it will take for you to normalize your insulin levels by eating the foods above, and the longer it will take for you to lose weight. And the same goes for reversing diabetes, reversing high blood pressure, etc. Be patient. Number two, take bouillon. Have 2 cups of bouillon a day when you cut the killer carbs for the first 2 weeks. This will help minimize the side effects of lower insulin, which can be having low blood pressure, less energy for 3 or 4 days, some headache or some fatigue. The bouillon helps restore your electrolytes and helps keep your blood pressure up as your body adjusts to its new method of energy burning. Number four, cholesterol changes. Your cholesterol may go up temporarily and only in the short term. You store cholesterol with your fat, so it may go up in the short term as you mobilize and you start to burn that fat. That's why you have an exam and blood test both before you cut the killer carbs and after you cut the killer carbs, so that you can know where your cholesterol started, and after 3 months or 6 months, you can see how much better your cholesterol, triglycerides, HDL, and small LDL are. Number four, eat the fat. Don't fight the fat. Not eating enough fat can actually make you feel nauseated. So don't try and avoid the fat. The fat is actually good for you. It'll help you feel full. Your body's already burning fat. And also, it has been reported that the more fat that you eat, the more improvement you have in your blood levels of cholesterol and triglycerides. Now here's a little example on how to count carbs. First of all, when you count carbs, you have to count the net carbs. The net carbs, inconveniently, they're not printed on the package. So you have to calculate that yourself. Number one, calculate it from the package. Net carbs equals the total carbohydrate minus the fiber. Or you can look up the net carbs on the internet. Simply Google net carbs in X. Second, you need to multiply to account for how many servings of that food you're going to eat. And the example we'll give here are Marcona almonds. I love these things. These are a great snack. They're salted almonds. So basically what you do is you take the total carbohydrate, which is 6 grams, you subtract out the fiber, which is 4 grams, and 6 minus 4 is 2. So that gives you 2 net carbs per serving. I usually eat 4 servings, so that's about 1/4 of the package, or about a cup. And 2 net carbs times 4 servings is 8 total net carbs in my snack. So that way I know how many net carbs I'm getting each time I have a snack like this. So now we're going to talk about the don'ts. The don'ts, these things are the killer carbs. In Weight Loss 101, what we talk about the whole time is cutting the killer carbs. So these are the killer carbs. These are the refined carbohydrates that spike your blood sugar, spike your insulin levels, and they make you gain weight. They give you high blood pressure, they give you diabetes, etc. Number one, don't eat sugars. These sugars include honey, syrup, jam, jelly, or candy. And don't eat any sweetener of any kind that's not listed on the do's above. People will say, what about maple syrup, or what about agave nectar, or what about brown rice syrup? You know, just stick to the sweeteners above listed in the do's, and you'll do fine. Number two, don't eat fruits canned with sugar. Fruit itself is okay, but when the fruit is canned with sugar or in heavy syrup, then it gets super high in carbohydrates. Number 3, don't eat sweets. Sweets include cakes, cookies, pies, puddings, ice cream, or ices. The only sweets that you should eat should be sweets that you make at home with your own ingredients listed above. For example, let's say you want ice cream. Any kind of ice cream that you buy at the store is going to be high carbohydrate. Well, what you can do is you can make your own ice cream at home, use heavy cream, use an approved sweetener, use some sort of fruit like berries, and you can make ice cream with minimal ingredients and it has minimal carbohydrates. So don't eat sweets unless you make them at home. The same thing goes for cookies. You can make super healthy low-carb cookies at home, but you're not going to be able to buy them at the store. Number 4, don't eat wheat products. Wheat products include bread or anything else that's made with flour. Even if the packaged food corporate marketing states that it's heart-healthy, whole-grain, sprouted, stone-ground, or the new zero-carb whole wheat miracle food, don't eat wheat or anything made of flour. If it has wheat in it, avoid it like the plague. This includes all bread products, cakes and cookies, even tortillas, noodles, spaghetti, macaroni, and any food that's made with flour or wheat flour. Packaged foods actually contain wheat under many other names, so it's best not to eat foods that come from a package. If you want to know the different names for what wheat can be listed as on a package, you can look up Dr. William Davis' book, Wheat Belly. Number 5, don't eat foods containing starch. Many foods contain something called starch, whether it's corn starch, rice starch, or potato starch, or some other starch. This is added to thicken the food, such as gravy or cream sauce, or any of a variety of packaged and processed corporate foods. These starches contain very high carbohydrates, similar to sugar or wheat. So avoid anything containing starch. Number 6, don't eat starch vegetables. Starchy vegetables include things like potatoes, whether they're sweet or Irish or yams, any of a variety of potatoes, they should be avoided. Also avoid them whether they're fried or baked or mashed. That doesn't make any difference. You should also avoid dried beans or peas. Dried beans or peas are just starchy types of vegetables. Most other root vegetables are also high in starch, so count the carbs on them. Turnips are a good substitute for potatoes. Number 7, don't drink colas or fruit juices. Carbonated drinks such as colas, ginger ale, pop, or root beer, those things contain too much sugar. The sugar may be called high fructose corn syrup, or the sugar may be called, natural imperial sugar, but they still have too many carbohydrates. In fact, fruit juices contain too much sugar as well. Even if the corporate marketing says it's 100% all natural antioxidant super organic juice, don't drink it because it's got too many carbs. You can have diet drinks sweetened with Splenda, which are preferred as opposed to aspartame. Number 8, don't eat cereals. Cereals include warm cereals such as oats or oatmeal, cream of this, malt of that, grits, cold cereals found in the breakfast aisle like Wheaty Bits and Tasty Squares and Yummy O's, different granolas and the like. Again, don't fall for the corporate marketing that says this is the latest heart-healthy oat and nut clusters or the cereal that lowers your cholesterol better than drugs. The fact is, if it's a cereal, you should avoid it. And number 9, don't drink beer. Beer is basically high-carbohydrate liquid bread, and they call it a beer belly for a reason. If you do choose to drink, count the carbs. And if you would like to stop drinking completely but feel you can't, number 1, contact your doctor, and number 2, download the audiobook Alcohol Lied to Me by Craig Beck with hypnosis. Now we'll do a little section on the supplements. Basically, I don't think you have to take a ton of supplements your whole life, but I do think that there are a few that could help you through this transition. Number 1, I do think you should take a high-quality multivitamin, and that's something you should probably take your whole life. You should take a high-quality multivitamin that includes the trace elements such as chromium, manganese, and molybdenum. That's because our soils are depleted of a lot of these trace elements, and so you may not get them in your food. Number two, omega-3s. Omega-3s are found in fish oil, and you can take 3,000 milligrams a day. You need to discuss with your doctor if this is right for you. Number three, tryptophan. Tryptophan is called 5-HTP, and you can take 50 to 100 milligrams per day, and that can assist with mood. If you're feeling a little bit depressed, tryptophan can help you pep up your mood a little bit during the transition. And finally, number four, L-glutamine. L-glutamine, you take 1 to 2 grams in heavy cream, sweetened with an acceptable sweetener, and that can be used to assist with sugar cravings, or carb cravings, or even wheat cravings for the first few weeks. Next, implementation strategies. You know, this isn't just a diet course that tells you this is the way you must do it. Because what you have to do is find what works for you. If counting carbs works for you, then do it that way. But if just deciding what to eat and what not to eat works for you, then do it that way. So I'm going to give you some different implementation strategies, and you can choose from one of these to adopt to really find something that works for you and makes sense in your mind. Number one, you can cut the killer carbs completely. This strategy is highly recommended. The killer carbs include bread, wheat, sugar, starches, such as potatoes and rice, and sweets. And you only eat from the do's above, and you count carbs when necessary. This is the recommended course if you have any of the diseases that are mentioned in the seminar, or if you have significant weight to lose. Cut those killer carbs completely. Implementation strategy number two is cut the killer carbs by 90%. This is how I implemented my diet initially, before eliminating refined carbs completely. It works and it works well, but I found that when I ate wheat, I would get indigestion and I was hungry with carb and wheat cravings 2 hours later. The problem is that if you don't cut out the wheat, there are still addictive wheat exorphins that remain in the diet. But this strategy can work, and it worked for me. Number three, a very simple approach is to eat at least 1/2 pound of meat or eggs at every meal. This was the diet that was given by the New York cardiologist. And what you do is you make sure you eat enough meat or eggs at every meal that you're not really hungry for anything else. This will help to decrease sugar and carb cravings. You can use some vegetables to make up the rest of your meals. And it has the same cautions as number two above. Remember, if there's a time when you eat carbs, you may have carb cravings 2 hours later. Number four, you can eat what you want and just count the carbs, remembering that less than 20 net carbs per day will cause you to lose weight rapidly. Less than 60 net carbs a day causes people to lose weight more slowly for most people. And somewhere above 60 net carbs, you'll start to gain weight. What that number is for you is unique, and you can basically watch how many carbs you eat each day to see how it works, to see what your unique number is. And the same cautions go as it for number two above, which means if there's times when you're counting carbs, but you eat wheat, then you may say, oh, 2 hours later you have a wheat craving or have a sugar craving. Implementation strategy number five is to eat only protein and vegetables. This was kind of how I thought of my diet initially, was the protein and vegetable diet. And you can eat as much protein as you want and as much green leafy veggies as you want at every meal. And I included nuts as being protein. So if you think protein and vegetables are the healthiest thing that you can do, then go about the diet that way. Or number six, you can just cut out the wheat and the gluten 100% and make no other changes. This sort of approach will be beneficial for your health, even if you don't lose weight, because it eliminates the number one addictive blood sugar raising, insulin-stimulating, body-acidifying, inflammatory carbohydrate right out of your diet. However, if you desire to lose weight, and the weight doesn't decrease simply with wheat elimination alone, then you have to move to one of the other options above. So pick the strategy that works best for you and stick with it for 3 months. This next section is what I call breads without the carbs. Because there are times when people really want bread and when you'll really want bread, but you have to find a way to make it that doesn't contain all of the refined blood sugar raising carbohydrates. So now it's time to cook something. You can use these books and sites for recipes. They include 1. The Wheat Belly Cookbook. 2. The Gluten-Free Almond Flour Cookbook. 3. Paleo Cooking from Alana's Pantry. 4. Against All Grain. 5. The website www.alanaspantry.com. And 6. The website www.primalpalate.com. Note, some of the cookbooks may recommend sweeteners and other products that are not on the list of do's above. Please stick to the approved sweeteners and only deviate from any of the do's by carefully counting the carbohydrates. Now let's move on to the tips. The first tip is double or triple your recipes. Look, you don't have time to cook every day. No one does, and no one expects you to. So if you're going to take the time to cook a bread, or muffins, or pancakes with a low-carb, wheat-free recipe, always double or triple that recipe. Then you can freeze the rest and defrost it in the microwave during the next week or two. Do the same for eggs. You can cook eggs baked in muffin cups or on a skillet, and it can be frozen for quick breakfast on the go. Tip number 2, lettuce wraps. Lettuce wraps are not just for Asian food anymore. Use a lettuce wrap for anything that you would formerly have put into a bun or a tortilla. It allows you to eat with your hands without the carbs of the bun. Tip number 3, avoiding wheat. If you're trying to avoid wheat 100% because of irritable bowel syndrome, or allergies, or acid reflux, or inflammatory diseases, be aware that wheat tends to be in everything. From ice cream, to Twizzle candies, to soy sauce, to Worcestershire sauce, to salad dressings. So, to avoid the wheat, you need to read all the labels carefully and consider buying gluten-free. Or, make the stuff yourself at home, as much as you can, with your ingredients. Finally, you can see the book Wheat Belly for a long list of aliases that may indicate the presence of wheat. Tip number 4. Gluten-free does not mean low-carb. These gluten-free products are often made with super high-carb starches that will spike your blood sugar as much or more than wheat. So you're better off making what you want at home and freezing it to use later. And tip number 5. Alternative flours for baking. Wheat flour has 92 net carbs per cup, and it has the addictive exorphins. That's why wheat is out. You've got to avoid it. Cornmeal still has 75 net carbs per cup, so avoid this also, except for an occasional corn tortilla if you just can't resist. Now, the next flour is chickpea flour. Chickpea flour is also called garbanzo bean flour. It has 43 net carbs per cup. It's much better than wheat or corn. You can use it sparingly for savory, not sweet breads. Next is coconut flour. Coconut flour has only 28 net carbs per cup. It's a really good thickener, and coconut flour can be used in place of wheat flour or cornstarch as a thickener, and it can be a component of either sweet or savory breads. Next is almond flour. Almond flour has only 9 net carbs per cup. It's excellent for sweet breads and for breading on chicken or fish. And finally, ground flaxseed. Ground flaxseed has 0 to 3 net carbs per cup, so it's virtually carb-free. It's also an excellent breading on chicken or fish, and it can be mixed with almond flour in that breading. It can also be used to make muffins and sweetbreads, and I use it to bulk up protein smoothies to make them more filling and satisfying. The next section of the handout here is books to read. The first book I recommend is Slim Now, Slim Forever by Craig Beck. Slim Now, Slim Forever, I recommend it because it's so short. It's short, it's small, it has a great discussion of the subconscious mind, and it discusses the low-carb diet and low-carb lifestyle. The book and the author can be a touch insensitive, so you may wish to skip this one if you're easily offended. It's not written by an MD. The next book I recommend is Wheat Belly. Wheat Belly is written by William Davis, MD. And this is the best book that really discusses low-carb dieting and the many problems with modern wheat in particular. The next book is The New Atkins Diet Revolution, or The Atkins Diabetes Revolution, if you have diabetes, written by Robert Atkins, MD. These books are very short as well, and they give lots of practical steps you can follow for a low-carb lifestyle. The whole basis of the Atkins diet is based on carb counting, so if you're really into carb counting, then get one of these Atkins books. The next two books go together. One is Why We Get Fat by Gary Tobbs, and the other is Good Calories, Bad Calories by the same author. If you have a very scientific mind and you need to be further convinced by the science that eating this way is really healthy and it's really what your body was intended to do, then get this book. Why We Get Fat goes through the entire history of low-carb diets, from them being common sense, everyone knew that carbohydrates were fattening, to a total flip in the paradigm to where low-fat diets are now common sense, and it discusses the science of both. If you want to an expanded edition of the same material, which covers all the scientific studies and details, simply get Good Calories, Bad Calories by the same author. It's hundreds of pages. It's not written by an MD, but it really covers most all of the applicable medical literature. And the final book I recommend for some people is a book called Clean by Alejandro Unger, MD. He's a physician. If you're dealing with lots of allergies, and those allergies aren't improved by cutting, number one, the wheat and all gluten sources, and if the allergies aren't improved by cutting, number two, the dairy out of your diet, then consider getting this book Clean. The book has to do a lot with juicing and fasting, and although I don't agree with everything that he says, he does have a good approach to cutting out offensive foods from your diet and then adding them back slowly, one by one by one, just one at a time. Okay, for this section of the handout, these are other links and information, and what I'm not going to do is read all the URLs, but I will tell you what you can Google, okay? The first is a free carbohydrate counter, and one is available at the Atkins website. You can simply Google Dr. Atkins Carbohydrate Gram Counter. The second thing that you should look at is a video by Dr. Eric Westman. This video is really powerful, and this is how Dr. Westman tells all of his patients at his clinic to do the low-carb diet. You can Google Dr. Eric Westman, Duke University, New Atkins Ketogenic Diet for Diabetics and Overweight. It's basically their introductory video of how to do the diet. Now, if you want to learn more about what is called the Paleo Diet, and basically an explanation of the Paleo Diet, simply Google Dr. Lauren Cordain on the Paleo Diet. The Paleo Diet Explained. It's a great video and discusses kind of why your body was intended to burn fat and burn protein, and it was not intended to burn refined carbohydrates. Now, if you want to be convinced a little bit more about the science, you can watch a presentation by Gary Tobbs, the author of Good Calories, Bad Calories. Simply Google Gary Tobbs, 1 of 10, Gary Tobbs at the Walnut Creek Library. It's a series of 10 separate videos, and it goes through the science of why refined carbohydrates are especially damaging to the human body. Another video that you might like to watch is one on the obesity epidemic. It has a great set of obesity states transition slides. I don't know the title of that video, but you can look at it in the handout and simply type that in. The next video is An MD Cures His Own Diabetes with Low Carb. This is a great video. This is a medical doctor. He was diagnosed with diabetes. And after his diagnosis, he decided, well, diabetes is a disease of carbohydrate metabolism, so why don't I just cut the carbohydrates out and then I won't be diabetic anymore? And that's exactly what he did. And then he's taken that message and passed it on to lots and lots of other people so that they can stop their medications too. The next video you should watch is My Big Fat Diet Canada. Simply Google My Big Fat Diet Canada. And it's the same doctor from An MD Cures His Own Diabetes who goes to this town in Canada and puts a lot of the townspeople on a low-carb diet. They get off their medications and lose weight and get healthier by cutting the refined carbohydrates. And this is the video where they said, the one guy said, within 4 days I was off 75% of my medication, and now I'm off all my medicine in 2 months of low-carb dieting. So within 4 days, he's off 75% of his medicine and off them all within 2 months. That's really powerful. In the handout, there's also a URL listed for acute, short, fat, and insulin video. You should get that URL from the handout and just type that in. In the book, Why We Get Fat, the appendix has a list of low glycemic foods to eat. So that would be a good comprehensive list of foods that you might want to look at, similar to the kind of list that I gave you in the do's above. There's also a website called www.dietdoctor.com. This guy has lots of videos and lots of information about low-carb eating, the low-carb lifestyle, and what you should eat and why you should eat it. The next thing that you may find useful is to simply Google the term TFY, High Capacity Scale with Body Composition Analyzer. This is a scale, but it also measures your body fat. Because what you'll find is that when you begin to lose weight, if your lean muscle mass is increasing but your fat mass is decreasing, your weight may stay the same. Even though your weight may stay the same, your body fat is changing. Your body fat is going down, down, down. And so sometimes using a body composition analyzer that measures your body fat would be very helpful for you. Next, if you're interested in stopping drinking, number one, contact your doctor. Number two, buy the audiobook, Alcohol Lied to Me by Craig Beck, which contains hypnosis. And number three, you're on a health journey here, so as long as you're making a lifestyle change, if you think you want to stop drinking, now is as good a time as any to stop. Next, to stop smoking. If you want to stop smoking, buy something called The Easy Way to Stop Smoking. The Easy Way to Stop Smoking is by a guy named Alan Carr, and he has a book. He has books, audiobooks, an online course, or even live courses. And once again, you're on a health journey, and if you're making lifestyle changes and you want to stop, now's as good a time as any to just stop smoking. And the Easy Way to Stop Smoking has a very high success rate. Finally, if you're looking for a local doctor who can help patients with low-carb diets, you're going to have to call around, ask your friends, ask at health food stores. I know who does it here locally in my town, but I don't know for all around the country. So just ask around at some of the health food stores and natural markets, and they'll have some of that information. Finally, locally, I know where you can get grass-fed, hormone-free beef. And we talked about this in the presentation. Grass-fed beef has more omega-3 fatty acids compared to the omega-6 fatty acids. But you need to find where you can get it locally. And lots of times, it'll be someone who just has a little ranch that's close to your home or close to your city. To find grass-fed, hormone-free beef in your locality, contact your local farmer's market, your organic grocer, natural foods market, health food store, or even a local meat processor for information in your area. They'll have some information for you. And these are just a few other things I wanted you to take home with you and kind of keep in mind as you begin your health journey on the low-carb lifestyle. The first thing is that the low-carb lifestyle has been hard at work since 1825. And this is a quote from The Physiology of Taste, published in 1825. So there's nothing new here. This is 200-year-old information, and it works. It's not a fad. It's something that has been common sense for a long time. So published 1825 by Jean-Brion Savarin. As it has already been clearly shown, it is only because of grains and starches that fatty congestion can occur as much in man as in the animals. It can be deduced as an exact consequence that a more or less rigid abstinence from anything that is starchy or floury will lead to a lessening of weight. Oh heavens, all you readers of both sexes will cry. Oh heavens above! But what a wretch the professor is. Here in a single word, he forbids us everything we most love. Those little white rolls and those cookies and 100 other things made with flour and butter and flour and sugar and flour and sugar and eggs. He doesn't even leave us potatoes or macaroni. Who would have thought this of a lover of good food who seemed so pleasant? What's this I hear? I exclaim, putting on my severest face, which I do perhaps once a year. Very well then, eat. Get fat. So since 1825, we have known that carbohydrates are uniquely fattening foods. This is not a fad. This is a well-known historical fact. And here's something else, another quote. This is from the William Banting's Letter on Corpulence, which was published in 1869. It says, "The items from which I was advised to abstain as much as possible were bread, butter, milk, sugar, beer, and potatoes, which had been the main and, I thought, innocent elements of my subsistence, or, at all events, they had for many years been adopted freely. These, said my excellent adviser, contain starch and saccharine matter, which is sugar, tending to create fat, and should be avoided altogether." So I'm not trying to tell you that low-carb lifestyle is the newest and latest diet fad out of a million diet fads. It's not a fad. It's just that human beings aren't made to eat refined carbohydrates. And it was published in 1869. This guy was 5'5", 200 pounds, and he lost 50 pounds by cutting the killer carbs. And you can do it too. The last part in this section says, keep it simple. Number one, do eat fat. You can eat fat, you can eat protein, eat it. Number two, just reduce the sweets and the starches. Number three, don't eat bread, crackers, pancakes, waffles, potatoes, rice, macaroni, spaghetti, corn, bananas, pie, cake, cookies, ice creams, unless you make those things yourself from your own ingredients, the only approved ingredients. Don't eat sherbets, candies, colas, raisins, jello, and all starches, sugars, and cereals. If you follow those three simple rules, then you can't help but lose weight, improve your blood sugar, improve your blood pressure, and improve your cardiovascular risk factors. Okay, and the final page in the handout is called The Metabolic Syndrome, Time to See Your Doctor. This is actually the final page we're going to cover. There's one more page, which is a comments form. So you should print out the comments form and fill it out and send it back. But this is the last one we'll cover in the recording. First of all, this form you should print out and you should carry it to your doctor's office. You need to see your doctor before beginning any kind of weight loss program, and you need to carry this sheet. The metabolic syndrome is basically a disease of carbohydrate metabolism. There are a bunch of metabolic abnormalities that are in common to the diseases of obesity, diabetes, and heart disease, and people with the metabolic syndrome have significantly higher rates of coronary, cardiovascular, and all-cause mortality, which means death from all causes, and death from heart disease. All of the metabolic abnormalities are exacerbated by the consumption of sugar, flour, and easily digestible carbohydrates. That means all the metabolic abnormalities of the metabolic syndrome are made worse by the killer carbs. Have your doctor test you for all the things below before you begin your low-carb lifestyle, and then have your doctor test you again after several months, and that could be 3 months, 6 months, or 12 months, after you have cut the killer carbs out of your diet. And remember that any weight loss program should be carried out under the direct supervision of your doctor. These are the things that you should have your doctor measure. Number one, your weight. Number two, elevated waist circumference. This is a waist measurement of 40 inches or more in men and 35 inches or more in women. Number three, elevated triglycerides, 150 milligrams per deciliter or higher. Number four, low HDL good cholesterol. If it's below 40 milligrams per deciliter in men or below 50 milligrams per deciliter in women. Number 5, high blood pressure. For systolic blood pressure, 130 millimeters mercury or higher and 85 millimeters mercury or higher diastolic blood pressure. So systolic is the top number, 130. Diastolic is the bottom number, 85. Next, elevated fasting blood glucose level and your hemoglobin A1C. Fasting blood glucose, 100 milligrams per deciliter or higher, is associated with metabolic syndrome. Number 7, hyperinsulinemia. This is a chronically high insulin level. Number 8, insulin resistance. This is insensitivity to insulin. This test does take some time and may not be offered at your doctor. Number 9, glucose intolerance. This test also takes time and may not be offered at your doctor, but if they do offer it, it would be useful to know. Because what you'll do is you'll improve your glucose tolerance as you cut the killer carbs out of your diet. Number 10, predominantly small, dense LDL particles. Your doctor will give you some sort of calculated LDL number unless you ask him specifically to measure your small, dense LDL particles. And that's why you carry this form with you. Because you carry this form with you because, you know, if you're a regular Joe and you don't know what all these medical tests are, you can't really go in there and just ask for them. So you carry the sheet with you, and that way your doctor knows what to test. Number 11 is high fibrinogen. This is a blood clotting factor. Number 12, elevated uric acid. This is seen in gout and pre-gout. Number 13, high CRP. This is a sign of chronic inflammation. And number 14, thyroid function tests. The thyroid function tests are not for metabolic syndrome, but they're because low thyroid can be associated with weight gain. And it may be possible that you're gaining weight because your thyroid is not working well. Finally, low-carb diets should not be used by anyone with severe kidney disease with a creatinine over 2.4. Also, women who are pregnant or nursing should not try to lose weight. And you really need to see your doctor because you need to ask about any other health problems that you have. And if you're going to start the low-carb lifestyle and you take medications, you're going to have those medications adjusted. So if you take medications for hypertension or congestive heart failure or diabetes, cholesterol, or diuretics, your doctor is going to have to adjust those medicines. So be sure and see your doctor before you start the low-carb lifestyle and carry this sheet with you. This ends session 5-2. Please continue with session 6.